6. Luke, the Gospel of Luke, chapter 23, reading from verse 26. And as they led him, Jesus, as they led him away, they led hold upon one Simon, a Cyrenian, coming out of the country, and on him they led the cross, that he may bear it after Jesus. And there followed him a great company of people and of women, which also bewailed and lamented him. But Jesus, turning unto them, said, Daughters of Jerusalem, weep not for me, but weep for yourselves and for your children. For behold, the days are coming in the which they shall say, Blessed are the barren, and the wombs that never bear, and the pups that which never have gave suck. Then shall they begin to say to the mountains, Fall on us, unto the hills, cover us. For if they do these things in a green tree, what shall be done in the dry? And there were also two others, malefactors, led with him to be put to death. And when they were come to the place which is called Calvary, there they were crucified, and the malefactors, one on the right hand, and the other on the left. Then said Jesus, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. And they parted his raiment, and cast lots. And the people stood beholding, and the rulers also with them derided him, saying, He saved the others, let him save himself, if he be Christ, the chosen of God. And the soldiers also mocked him, coming to him and offering him vinegar, and saying, If thou be the king of the Jews, save thyself. And the superscription also was written over him in letters of Greek and Latin and Hebrew, This is the king of the Jews. And one of the malefactors which were hung railed on him, saying, If thou be Christ, save thyself and us. But the other answering rebuked him, saying, Dost not thou fear God, seeing thou art in the same condemnation? And we indeed justly, for we receive the due reward of our deeds. But this man has done nothing amiss. And he said unto Jesus, Lord, remember me when thou comest into thy kingdom. And Jesus said unto him, Verily I say unto thee, today shalt thou be with me in paradise. And it was about the sixth hour, and there was a darkness over all the earth until the ninth hour. And the sun was darkened, and the veil of the temple was rent in the midst. And when Jesus had cried with a loud voice, he said, Father, into thy hands I commit my spirit. And having said thus, he gave up the ghost. May the Lord bless the reading of his word and grant us all understanding as we study it. Let's sing together hymn 100, the Gospel of Luke, chapter 23, and reading verse 43. And Jesus said unto him, Luke 23, verse 43, and Jesus said unto him, Verily I say unto thee, today shalt thou be with me in paradise. Our subject is drawn from the text, very simple, today in heaven. That's the subject. And this leads us to our third study in the last seven sayings of Christ on the cross. But chronologically, this is the second one. But in our studies, this is the third. And we remember that all the seven last sayings of Christ on the cross and from the cross are all found in Psalm 22. And Psalm 22 has been written 1,000 years before the cross. So Christ was hanged on a cross. He was crucified. But even on the cross, he was denied, he was dying, but not defeated. He was crucified, but not conquered. He was forsaken, but not shaken. Even to the end, up to the end, Christ can still think about other people. Isn't that a lesson? When we are suffering, we should be more thinking about other people. Every trial, every difficulty we go through, more we think about ourselves, more we are taking the wrong way. But whatever situation, whatever trial, whatever trouble comes to us, as Jesus gave us the example, we must be thinking about how we can be a comfort to other people. So that's already one example we can see from this second last saying of Christ at the cross of Calvary. But remember, each statement uttered by Christ at the cross gives us a hint, gives us an idea about his heart, about his character, about his nature, but also about his personality. And this is why you are downcast, you are discouraged. Oh, my challenge for you, please read, just reading them, not even studying each one of the seven last sayings of Christ on the cross. There will be a spiritual food, a spiritual opportunity to lift you up and to focus your mind on what Christ has done on the cross for sinners. So anything and everything which has happened on the cross was not a surprise to Christ. Nothing happened unexpectedly. All was foretold, as I was mentioning earlier, Psalm 22, 1,000 years before. And you can read again Psalm 22. All the seven sayings, last sayings of Christ are mentioned in Psalm 22. But nothing happened as unexpected. So many times when you read the gospel, the four gospels, each one of them, just taking an example, the gospel of Matthew, at least three times, Jesus spoke and told his disciples that he is going to die. In Matthew 16, in Matthew 17, in Matthew 20. So they knew, and Christ knew everything which is going to happen to him. Oh, he knew it all. But as he said, his death is unavoidable. It is inevitable. If Christ did not die on the cross of Calvary, nobody would be saved. Even believers of the Old Testament. What about believers of the New Testament and us today? So everyone must be looking at what happened on the cross of Calvary. Christ died on that cross for sinners. So it was unavoidable. It was inevitable. But remember in John 10, he said, I have power to give my life, but I also have power to take it back. So he has that power. And each gospel, without any contradiction, you read each gospel about this seven, because I want to focus really more on this second last saying of Christ on the cross of Calvary. Each gospel gives you more details and make the story so complete that each one of us can have an idea about what has happened at the cross of Calvary. So coming to our text, we want to look to set up the scene. There is something happening there to lay down a foundation. And remember, Christ was crucified, but he was not crucified alone on that cross. On that day at Calvary, there were three crosses: the Redeemer, the Repenter, and the Rejecter. Why am I saying that? one of the men who died on the cross died in sin. The second man died to sin, but the Lord Jesus Christ died for sins. And on that cross, while Jesus was hanged, while Jesus was punished in a sense, while Jesus was crucified on that cross, we are told through the Gospels that Christ was crucified between two thieves, two malefactors, two evildoers, two transgressors. Any evil word you can think about can be applied to the two thieves mentioned and crucified during that time with the Lord Jesus Christ on the cross. And it's interesting because Luke tells us that Christ was crucified between them. Now, we do not know which one was crucified first, if it was Christ or one of the thieves first. We do not know. Those details are not given to us. But the most important, we are told that Jesus Christ was crucified in the midst of two thieves, of the two transgressors, and even it is so precise that it is said one on his right and one on his left. But why did that happen? Oh, again, we go back, you don't need to turn there, but the text is Isaiah 53, verse 12, which says that Jesus was counted, was numbered among the transgressors. So, I said Psalm 22 is 1,000 years before this happened, but Isaiah 53, this is 700 years before it happened. And when you read that text, there are so many wonderful things said. If I could just mention four of them. This is just in one verse, Isaiah 53, verse 12. The first thing mentioned there, that Jesus was poured out his soul unto death. Jesus poured out his soul unto death. In Isaiah 53, verse 12. The second thing mentioned there, he was numbered with the transgressors. The sinless man. The one who never said anything wrong. The one who never thought anything wrong. The one who never had a bad temper. Here he is, hanged between two thieves, two bandits, two gangsters, two brigands. This is how we can qualify them. But also we are told in Isaiah 53, verse 12, 13, that he has bare the sin of many, and the 14 said there, and made intercession for transgressors. 700 years before it happened, the prophet Isaiah mentioned that Jesus is going to die exactly between, not on the side, or on the right, or on the left, but exactly in the midst, in the middle of those two transgressors. Oh, the word of God is so precise on those issues. So, and that is confirmed to us in the Gospel of John, chapter 18, verse 30. And that day, both of the criminals, and I hope you will appreciate this, both of the criminals, they went through the same sufferings. They experienced the same pain, the same agony. But their reactions were completely different. They went through the same pain. They saw the event with the same eyes, and they heard the same words, but the way they reacted, what they said, and the way things came to an end were completely different, and their reaction was completely different. Oh, just to explain, one of them remained unshaken and blind about his spiritual status. He didn't see his spiritual needs. But the second, he saw himself before God. He saw his spiritual needs. He saw his spiritual condition. And what did he do? He begged for mercy. Oh, one faced damnation, while the second found salvation. The one who denied Christ, who didn't want to have anything to Christ, he prayed also. But what is interesting and important to mention, he prayed just to save his neck or to save his head. Like so many nowadays, why do you believe in God? Oh, I just want to believe in God because life is so hectic. There are so many troubles in life. So I need God. God will help me to cope with my exam. God will help me to cope with my sickness. God will help me to have a new job. And so on. But people don't need God because they don't need their sins to be mentioned. They don't need to be told one day we shall stand before the living God and to be judged. They don't want to hear about hell. Oh, please, preacher, don't speak to me about hell tonight. You will spoil my day. This is what is happening in this world. So one prayed just to save his head. One the second, oh, he's an example to us. He prayed to save his soul. His priceless soul, he prayed to save his soul. One died as a sinner, not forgiven, but the second died as a same sinner, forgiven from all his sins. So that day, from 9 o'clock, the text tells us, from 9 o'clock to 12 o'clock, under a blazing sun, the sun was at its zenith, so warm, the two thieves who were crucified with Jesus, with the Lord Jesus Christ, in Mark, in Matthew, but also here in Luke, we are told that they joined the crowd and they were insulting, they were blaspheming, they were jeering, they were taunting, and they were shouting at the Lord Jesus Christ. And when you read the Gospel of Mark, we are told that they were insulting Jesus with exactly the same words. So sometimes we think just the good one was the good one didn't say anything wrong. But from 9 o'clock to 12 o'clock, each one of them, they were on the same line. They were on the same channel. But at 12 o'clock, we are told one man has completely changed and he will never be the same again. What happened to him? Oh, he saw Christ. He realized that Christ is special. He realized that Christ is like no one else, and he was captivated. So this is why, in studying our second statement, last statement of Christ on the cross, I want to continue or go forward with 3 points. The first one, let us look again at the man. What has changed in his life? The second point we will make is to look at his confession, and we'll close by looking at his salvation. So the man, his confession, and then his salvation. So let's come back to him again. We said much about him already, but it's important to remind ourselves that this man, when he was put on the cross at 9 o'clock that day, he was a fearless man. He was a faithless man. He was also a lawless man. What was his philosophy? His philosophy is the law of Tiger. One an eye for an eye, a tooth for a tooth. But what happened to him? While being on that cross, he heard something, because remember, he feared neither God nor man. But while hanging on that cross, from 9 o'clock to 12 o'clock, something happened to him, and the first thing which brought him to a change, he heard a prayer. He heard a prayer. What prayer did he hear? Oh, the first last statement of Christ on the cross of Calvary, which was, it is mentioned in Luke 23 here, verse 34, then Jesus said, Father, forgive them. And that thief on the cross was among his tormentors, his torturers, the people who were blaspheming against him, who were insulting him, jeering all the day, for they know not what they do. And Paul is saying to us in 1 Corinthians 2, that if they knew what they were doing, they would have not crucified the Lord of glory. Oh, so many times we do so many things, we do not see the repercussions, we do not see the consequences. Everything we do have consequences, either on us or on other people. But here, that day, maybe he never prayed in his life. He never experienced forgiveness in his life. But that day, he heard the Lord Jesus Christ praying for his enemies, praying for his opponents, praying for those who were against him, those who spurned him, and he was praying for them. So what brought the change in his life? He heard a prayer. But I believe, I cannot defend, I cannot prove you much about it. But when you go back to verse 28 of the same chapter, maybe he heard what Jesus was saying to the women, because the women were trying to encourage the Lord Jesus Christ. They were trying to weep for him. But Jesus, turning unto them, verse 28, said, "Daughters of Jerusalem, weep not for me, but weep for yourselves and for your children." Maybe, I'm saying maybe, he heard that. But he also heard a prayer. And then he heard the whole message. Remember, there was a whole crowd. A crowd. Some people were passing by. Some were standing by the cross. Some were moving their head. They were so disappointed in an ironical way. And so on. So there were a number of people by the cross of Calvary on that day. And many of them were mocking the Lord Jesus Christ. Actually, they were preaching like a sermon, saying, "Oh, if you are the Son of God, if you are the Messiah, if you are the chosen one of God, come down from that cross, save yourself, and save us too." So that thief on the cross heard the message. Oh, they didn't believe in what they were saying, but at least they knew that the person of Christ on that cross was completely different than anyone else. He heard the message. He heard the prayer. But here is something I believe. Again, I cannot prove you, because somebody on the cross reading, that's a bit hard. But I think he read something. He read what we may call the smallest gospel tract in the world, written in three languages. It was written in Greek, which was the wise people education language. It was written in Latin, which was the official language. But it was written also in Hebrew, which was the common people language. Aramaic was the common people language. So this is why we believe that God has no sacred language. God is not an Arab. God speaks every language. God wants his word to be translated. And one of the proofs, I think I have told you before, for me, one of the proofs that the Bible, or there are hundreds of proofs that the Bible is the inspired, inerrant word of God, without error, without contradiction. But one of the great proofs that the Bible is the word of God, it is translatable in any language. It is translated, it still keeps its power. Why? Because it is of God. God has inspired it, and it will never change. Men tried, they burned it, they spurned it, they walked at it, they made fun of it. The liberals, the German liberals, you remember the high criticism? They tried to put down the Bible. But the word of God continues to stand forever. So he heard that message. What is the smallest gospel tract in the world? It is in Luke 23, verse 38. And a superscription also was written over him in letters of Greek and Latin and Hebrew. This is the King. So this is why I said, maybe, I don't know if it was able to turn his head. I hardly can imagine that, because on the cross, it was painful, because a person dies on the cross by suffocation. He's not even able to move himself anymore on that time. But even if he was not able to read it, he may have heard people say it. And each gospel gives us a little bit something different, but always you find that expression, Jesus, the King of the Jews. And we will come to that, because later you can see how we speak to the Lord Jesus Christ. Oh, we must move on. Now we come to his confession, because really there is much we could have added there. So the man, we see he heard the prayer, but also he heard the message, then he read that smallest gospel tract written in three languages. Then we come to his confession. And something amazing and astonishing happened to him and happened to the, in the life of this man. That now, when you look at the text, his journey of faith will start at that time. The journey of faith will start. There was a sudden world face in his life. A world face occurred in his life at this particular time. Because we see from the text that he stopped swearing and reviling and made a wonderful confession. And that wonderful confession, you can start to read it from verse 39 to verse 42. Then you have what he said. But I will explain more on what he said in due time. Because his confession of faith will tell us also something amazing about and gives us evidence of any true conversion. If somebody is converted, he can trace the element, the evidences of his conversion by comparing his life with the life of this man. And that gives us a pattern, really. There are evidences of every true conversion, but there is also a pattern to see. If you know the Lord, or you want to seek and find the Lord, there are five of them. And I will list them very quickly, because they are very clear from the text. What happened to him and brought him to a change? Oh, the first one. He came to his senses. Does it remind you something? The prodigal son. So, which means unbelief, atheism, is foolishness. Because not to believe in God, or that you need more faith not to believe in God than to believe in God. What's the matter with you? That's the question we should put to the atheists. There is that he came to his senses. And what happened? He saw that he is a sinful person. He saw that he is guilty. And now he looks at his fellow thief, and he believes that both of them deserve what they got that day. They deserve it. It's in verse 40. Verse 40, he mentions that they deserve to be on that crucifixion that day. But the other answering rebuked him, saying, "Does not thou fear God, seeing thou art in the same condemnation?" So, what brought the change into his life? He came to his senses, he believed that, he acknowledged that he is a sinner, that he is guilty, and he deserved what happened to him on that day. The verdict was right, and he rebuked also his fellow thief, his companion of misfortune on that time. So he realized that he has done wrong, but he has also wronged God. Remember, sin is always against the living God. And this is what this man has realized. But second, in verse 40, he realized that sin must be punished. Sin must be punished. Sin is heinous and hideous. You know, sin is never small. We have an illustration to describe how sin is never small. We say sin is like fire, it's never so small. Even a sparkle of fire can burn a whole forest. And this is about a Bedouin camel. I was brought up with camels. And this Bedouin has a camel, and it was very cold. It's, of course, just a poor illustration. And the camel, even a fairy tale, the camel, it was so cold in the desert, the camel saw his owner under the tent. And he said, "Can I put my head?" The owner said, "Yes, you can put your head." It was very cold. And soon he asked again, "Can I put my neck, my long neck?" "Oh, yes, come in." A few moments later, the camel said, "Can I come in?" The camel came in. Where was the owner? Outside, and the camel is. Sin is never small. Sin will take you more than you have planned. And sin will cost you more than you want to pay. So he saw his need, but he saw his condition also as a sinner. And this is what, look what he says in verse 40 there. "And He said to his fellow thief, "Dost not thou fear God?" His conscience told him now to fear God. There is somebody to fear. We must fear God. Oh, if only sinners should tremble before the living God. Whom should we fear? God first. And it takes me to Matthew 10, verse 28, where Jesus said, "Fear not men. They can kill only the body. Whom should you fear? Fear God. Because God can kill the body and take the soul and put it in heaven. It's God we should fear. We shouldn't fear of any man. The fear of man is a trap. It's a trap. We should never fear man. Man can do nothing to us. But his words are a rebuke to the whole world. His words are a message to the whole world. And we remember what the wisest of men, King Solomon, said at the end of Ecclesiastes chapter 12, verse 13. He said, "Let us hear the conclusion of the whole matter. Fear God and keep his commandment, for this is the whole duty of man." And then in Proverbs 1, verse 7, he says, "The fear of the Lord is the beginning of knowledge." Just the beginning. There is more. But the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. It is also the beginning of knowledge. So we can see that was the second aspect in his conversion, or the first thing. He came to his senses and he knew about his sinfulness and his guilt. The second, he knew that sin must be punished and he must fear God. Just God. Fear God. And when Peter was invited at Cornelius, we remember what he said to Cornelius. Oh, he was a Jew. He didn't want to interact with any Gentile. They were like the unclean, the impure, the dogs of that time, with no relation with the Jews who saw themselves as a superior. They made of God their private property. But what did Peter say to Cornelius in Acts chapter 10? In every nation, God is not respecter of persons, but in every nation, he that fear him and worketh righteousness is accepted of him. In every nation, everyone who worketh righteousness and fear him shall be accepted by God. There is the third thing. I must hurry. The third one, he saw that Jesus is holy, Jesus is harmless, Jesus is undefiled, Jesus is innocent, Jesus is sinless. I'm quoting from Hebrews chapter 7, verse 26. All those qualificatives are said there about the Lord Jesus Christ. But he realized that. This man realized that Jesus is innocent. He has done no harm. He's righteous. So his confession, Jesus, even though badly mistreated, dying like a criminal, Jesus is Lord, he is God, he is the chosen one. The fourth one, he realized and he believed that there will be a day of judgment. He knew that. There will be a day of judgment. Every one of us, 2 Corinthians 5 verse 10, every one of us must stand before the judgment seat of Christ. And in that day, we will give account of any thought, any deed, and any word. Your works, your thoughts, everything will be scrutinized before the living God. And we will have to pay for every evil word we said, every evil word we did, and every evil thought we thought about. Oh, that day, there will be no negotiation. No bribery. You can do that with men, but not with the living God. But there is a last, the fifth one, related to this man. And it is found in verse 42. He said, Christ, when he prays to Christ, he addressed Christ. In verse 43, he said, verse 42, I beg your pardon, verse 42, and he said unto Jesus, Lord, Lord, remember me when thou comest into thy kingdom. I ask you, brothers and sisters, if the Lord has a kingdom, who is he? He's a king. Oh yes, in this particular time, he had a crown of thorns on his head, but yet the Lord Jesus Christ is the Lord of lords and the King of kings. This is why I started in my introduction saying, even on the cross of Calvary, Jesus is still the Lord, Jesus is still the Redeemer, Jesus is still the Savior, oh, Jesus is still our everything. King of kings and lords of lords. So we come again to this man, looking at him. And this man, Pastor spoke on Sunday about Noah being the preacher of righteousness. When I was studying this man on the cross, he never had an opportunity. The only opportunity he had to preach, it was on the cross. And can I call him also a preacher of righteousness? Because the way he preached to his fellow companion, his partner in crime, the way he preached to that man shows that he has understood how we can be saved only by faith, only by grace, and nothing else. So he's a preacher of righteousness. So after speaking to his fellow thief, now he turns to Christ. And look in verse 42, what he says to Christ. And he says to Christ, remember me. Oh, isn't that a wonderful word? Wonderful expression. When I read it, it's like a child, you know, with tears, but not tears of crocodile. Sincere, genuine, earnest tears. A child saying to his mom and dad, Dad, Mom, remember me. And here is an adult crucified on the cross of Calvary, bleeding, in pain, suffering, and he's able to lift up his voice. You are not suffering. You are not in the same position. Oh, if you have never seek and find the Lord, I'm speaking to you. It's so easy to stress again, my pain. You will never suffer like this man. But in a last effort, he was able to speak and he said, remember me. You know what it means by saying remember me? By faith, he believed that Jesus will raise again from the dead and will reign again. How do I know that? It's in the expression, remember me. Because remember also, by 3 o'clock on that day, all the people who have been crucified were dead. And we remember even the soldiers will come and break their bones. But they didn't break the bones of the Lord Jesus Christ again to fulfill a scripture from the Old Testament. So on that day, he knows, this thief knew that he will never be able to speak again on this earth, but he realized that Jesus Christ will raise from the dead, but also Jesus Christ will come back and reign. So he believed that. But the second thing, by saying, remember me, is that it's his one word. You see, to believe in Christ or to confess our sins to the Lord Jesus Christ, we don't need to be borrowing words from here and there, imitating just what someone else has said. There are so many confessions, there are so many words of sinner prayers through the scriptures in Luke 18, verse 13, be merciful upon me, a sinner. But here, his own words is remember me. What was he saying by saying remember me? Oh, simply it means, Lord, save me. Lord, make of me one of yours. Lord, forgive my sins. That was what he meant by saying, remember me. We will not have time to make the parallel, but later if you are able to study the same text, you can see there is a wonderful parallel about what he said and the way the Lord Jesus Christ answered him. And there is a dialogue. This is why our faith is not a monologue, but a dialogue with the living God. When we pray, when we read the scripture, there is a dialogue. And we find this dialogue with this man on the cross of Calvary. Oh, if I can just give you quickly an example. When he said to the Lord Jesus Christ, and actually this is found only in the Gospel of Luke. Only in the Gospel of Luke you find this dialogue. So here, when he said to Christ, oh, accept me in your kingdom, what did Jesus give him? Jesus gave him a place in heaven. Not just in a kingdom, but in heaven. When he said, Lord, the Lord said to him, verily. When he said, remember me, the Lord said to him, you shall be with me. Oh, this is more than just remembrance. It's in the thoughts, no, it's bodily. You will be with me in spirit today. Where I will be, you will be there also. And salvation is about fellowship and relationship. And he said to Jesus, when thou comest, but Jesus said to him, today. So that's the parallel. I wish I could have more to say there, but there is more to come. So this man has nothing to offer on that day. But when everyone rejected the Lord, he identified himself with Christ and he believed in Christ. No baptism, no Lord's Supper, no church going, no discipleship course, no good works, no ritual. Oh, please. The Catholics, this is nonsense. They said that thief was baptized, and you know how they defended? They said when they pierced the side of the Lord Jesus Christ, the blood and water which came out from him sprinkled that thief. Here he is, he was baptized. But this is completely, when you read the story, again, the testimony of this thief on the cross, we do not believe in regenerational baptism. It's unbiblical. It is an invention of man. Nowhere in the scriptures. But again, you can see that this man on the cross, today he was invited to enter in heaven. But again, brothers and sisters, before I come to the third point to speak about his salvation, please never make last minute bedside confession. And don't use this example to defend it. You cannot live as a devil and die like an angel. It's impossible. It's impossible. Nowhere in the Bible you can justify that. But here, this man, he had nothing to offer. No more pride by trust. He saw his guilt and no one to blame, no school to blame, no church to blame, no God to blame, no society to blame. He blamed himself. He knew that he is the guilty one, he is the sinful one. From reviling to revival to repentance, he had a new insight about himself, about Christ, about the life to come, about judgment. Oh, here is the third element, about his salvation. In spite of all the noise, all the pain, Jesus was still able to hear the whispering of a prayer. You remember, we are told in the scriptures that Christ kept silent. He said nothing. But you want the Lord Jesus Christ to act and react? Oh, the prayer. When a believer prays, the Lord Jesus Christ will never remain indifferent. And this is what we see in this situation. So how did his salvation happen? And what are the promises the Lord Jesus Christ gave him? And they are made in the text. They are in front of us in verse 43. And look how the Lord Jesus Christ answered him. The first thing he said, verily I say unto thee. That is a word of assurance. That is a word of a promise. Surely, verily, amen, it's the word amen, I say unto thee. And this statement is mentioned 77 times in the four Gospels. And it is always said by the Lord Jesus Christ. I call it Jesus' signature. That is his stamp. Amen, amen. It was something he often said. But it's like, it has the force of an oath, like said by God, but it has also the authority of a king. So by saying to him, verily I say unto thee, Jesus is speaking to him like a God, but also like king. So what a promise, and we remember, God is not a man that he should lie. So he said unto him, firstly about his salvation, verily I say unto thee. And the second thing which Jesus said to him, today. You know, there is a, the punctuation is very important, because when you speak with Jehovah's Witnesses, they tell you in verse 43, here is what they say, and Jesus said unto him, verily I say unto thee today. Like they said, Jesus is speaking to him about now, okay? I'm speaking to you now, and comma. But the comma comes, verily as it is in our AV here, verily I say unto thee, comma, today. Not tomorrow, but today. Oh, what a swiftness. What a haste to be saved today in an instant. But heaven, you see, he can go to heaven because heaven comes to us before we go to heaven. It's a matter of life and death that it must be today. Purgatory is a hype. It's not a hope. It's never mentioned in the Bible. Soul sleeping is never mentioned in the Bible. The only time the word purge is mentioned in the Bible, it's in Hebrews chapter 1, verse 3 and 4, and it is said it was completed. Christ purged for our sins. He took our sins. He bare our sins on the cross of Calvary. So it's done. That's an invention. Purgatory, the sleeping of the soul, is an invention of the Catholic Church. But Jesus said to him, thou shalt be with me. Thou. Salvation is individual, is personal. You alone, not the other fellow. You alone. And you see, thou shalt be. There is a power in that expression. It's active. And the Lord said to him, with me. Oh, what a company. There is no better company than to be with the Lord Jesus Christ. So he's granted fellowship and friendship forever. And as Jesus said, where I am, I want my people to be there. No more condemnation, no more separation. And finally, Jesus said to him, thou shalt be with me today in paradise. Today in paradise. Not tomorrow, not in 10 years, not in 100 years, but today. Oh, what a company, what a place to be. Not in the grave, but in heaven, a place of eternal bliss. Oh, to be there with Christ is far better. Here is my conclusion. The Lord Jesus Christ wants our holiness. God's greatest concern about you and me, it's not to make us happy. This is why so many churches have gone wrong. What do you want? Oh, why do I come to church? I want to be happy. Make me happy. But you see, the greatest concern of God for you and me is to make us holy. Hopefully, a holy person, a Christian living a holy life should be also a happier person. There is no more sad person than a sad Christian, believe me. Because to be joyful, rejoice, Philippians 4:4, it is a command. The Christian must rejoice, but we rejoice in the Lord. There is no wrong time to come to Christ as long as it is today. To be saved, one has not to wait until a distant future. And this is a great example. I have no time. As Pastor will say, I wish I have more time to say more. But here, just with this example, I wish I have the whole time with you. There are the five pillars rediscovered at Reformation. Oh, can I say? They are all here. You study it for yourself. Grace alone, he did nothing to deserve salvation. Faith alone, he just believed that the Christ on that cross was the living God, he's the Messiah, he's the Lord. But Christ alone, he was alone on that cross with Christ. So literally, what Paul said in Galatians 2:20, I have been crucified with Christ, happened to him on that day. But faith alone, it happened to him, but the glory of God alone. All the five pillars of Reformation are here before Reformation. You can see that the glory of God, whom should you fear? God alone. He said to his fellow thief, fear God and nobody else. So if Christ saved this man while he was dying, What about today, brothers and sisters? What about today? Is he alive? Yes, the Lord Jesus Christ is alive. Oh, if I can read Hebrews 7, verse 25, because this is mentioned there. There is something wonderful. A text to save a sinner, to take him from earth and bring him into heaven, close to the living God. Wherefore, Hebrews 7, verse 25, wherefore he is able also to save them to the uttermost that come unto God by him, seeing he ever liveth to make intercession for them. Christ is alive. And if he was able to save such man in that particular time, what about today as he is alive? A simple prayer, but it is worth much with no prior condition. He didn't ask to be saved from the cross, but grace will always give you more than hoped for, more than asked for, and more than requested. And Jesus determines our destination and our destiny. Death is not a vacuum. Death is not the end of everything. We can know now. If you have never seen and found the Lord, you can know now where you will spend life after death. And this is why I close with this. John said, "These things have I written unto you, that believe on the name of the Son of God, that ye may know that ye have eternal life." In verse 12, 1 John 5, verse 12, he said, "He who has the Son has life. He who has not the Son of God has no life." Oh, there is more. Again, you could have said that tonight, but this is enough for tonight. May the Lord bless his word into our lives and grant us all understanding. Let's close by singing hymn number 202. Hymn number 202. How sweet the name of Jesus sounds in a believer's ear. Hymn number 202.